What is present and transgressing and how forward the work? Forward the work is a good guy because it's copyright converter. Russian in CCM can handle larger power than a fiber converter, but it costs a lot. And we will see from the stress analysis that the maximum power that a forward converter can handle is something around, well, depends, as usual, that there are many exceptions, but not so much. It's like 200 watts. 200 watts forward converter is already probably at its limit. You have to be very careful to design a 200 watt converter. With forward topology. There are other topologies that are able to handle more power. For a forward converter, usually it's a few hundred watts, 100, 200, something like this. Anyway, D1, just to take a reference to the schematic that is over there, so D1 is freewheeling now. D1, maximum reverse voltage across D1, because when we are T on. During T on, D1 is open, and the voltage across D1 is just equal to the input voltage multiplied by the term ratio by an S over a T. And somebody could tell me, V8 minus V switch minus VRS. Well, VRS could be very small. The A could be very small, the current is small. And more important, who cares about 1 volt out of 300 volts or something like this? This is the maximum voltage, and then no matter what we find out from this VD1, we will look for a diode whose rating is not just half a volt more than what we need. We want to have some extra safety knowledge. Even if we neglect here V minus VRS minus whatever it is, even if here we neglect VD2, that's okay. This is more or less the maximum that you can have. VD2 is the forward diode. It's a diode that conducts during T on. So it will be reverse biased during T off. And the reverse bias during T off is equal to what is the reverse bias during T off?
The voltage.
Well, on the right hand side of D1 there is 0 volts because if the D1 is conducting, so D2 has its right side ground. And how much is the voltage on the secondary side during T off? What determines the voltage on the secondary side during T off? Or the voltages across the transformers? Voltages during T off transformer are determined by tertiary winding. Because during T off, D3 is conducting, and across the tertiary winding there is V, and all other voltages, primary and secondary, are determined by the tertiary winding that has V in across it. So VD2 equals V in times NS over NT. And if you want to write it down in a different way, you can write NS over NT because we didn't find the NS over NT, you can write here NS over NT times NT over NT. That's the same story. Depends if you already have this number or if you have only these two numbers. VD3, this is a small diode. There is not so much current flowing through it, but there is a voltage across it. And D3, this diode is non-conducting during T on. to T on, that is V in, across the primary winding. This V is moved to the secondary winding in the standard forward converter operation. But this V in is also transferred to the tertiary winding and in the opposite way. So there is a negative over here. And VD3 has a crosshead on the cathode side, there is V, and on the anode side, there is V in times NT over NP. So we have V in times NP over, V in plus V in times NP, NP. And B and T over A and B. The voltage over here is equal to V in, negative V in times and T over P, and it is subtracted to this voltage of this side. So we get this expression. What else? Less weights. How much is the voltage across the switch? Obviously, when the switch is
open.
Switch is open, the voltage across the windings are driven, are ruled by tertiary winding, as VD across it, VN across it. So, this switch will be equal to input voltage plus the voltage across VP, right? The reflected one. This is exactly in a buck boost in a flyback converter. So we have V in plus V in times NP over NP, because this is what is coming back from the tertiary and reflected to the primary, and plus V spy. If it is well controlled, you can take a 20% or so of the input voltage. Okay, those are the voltage stresses. Let's see, do we take the maximum, the minimum, or the average? We are looking for the maximum stress, so that will be the maximum. Or the minimum max. And here we see a bad surprise about the forward converter. If you look at the switch stress is quite large. It's V plus another V multiplied by a number. If we go with our standard, not standard, initial choice, that is NP over T equals 1, duty cycle maximum is 0.5, we have that the switch voltage is more than twice the input voltage. If you design a power supply offline, connected to the mains, you can have 230 volts or more, because there is a tolerance, times square root of 2, that is the peak value, and you get something around 350 volts. 350 volts, there, plus another 350 volts, that is multiplied by 1, if we use our initial choice, is 700 volts, plus another 100 volts or so, we are 800 volts. That's what means that we need to use a transformer, a transistor that has a 1 kilo voltage rating. They exist, but they start to be not so common. It's a bit expensive, dowsing means with a high RDS on. Basically, this is an important limitation of forward converter. If you exit at low voltage, usually these stresses are not so important. But if instead of going out at 30 volts, you have an output voltage of 300, 400 volts, that could be a lot as well. Because if your NS over NP as mean the output voltage is around 400, 500 volts, this voltages can be quite high as well. But But usually the worst situation, the most critical condition is this one, input voltage. That is what limits, especially high input voltage, the forward converter. Can we reduce this stress? Sure. We have to reduce NP over NT. Can we do it? Yes, probably yes. If NP over NT decreases, we can reduce it. It means that our duty cycle must, my maximum duty cycle is decreased, becomes smaller. Okay, let's suppose that we want NP over NT equal to 0.5. How much is the maximum duty cycle that you can have in order to get 0.5 as NP over NT? That is a difficult equation to solve. Because 0.25 divided by 0.75 is 1/3.
1/1.5.
1/1.5? Yes.
2/3
is too much. 1/3. You have 1/3 divided by 2/3 is 0.5. So Dmax equals 0.32. Okay. That is a possible choice. Could be dangerous, but let's suppose that we choose this. Oh, this implies that my D max, my maximum D, is 1/3. And if my maximum D is 1/3 instead of 0.5, 0.4, whatever I picked at the beginning, NS over NP becomes, Dmax goes down, and that's what B becomes larger. Okay, can be done. But if NS over B becomes larger, the voltage stress across D1 increases. That's okay, it's usual, standard stuff. We decrease the voltage stress on a component, we increase the voltage stress on a component as well. And let's see what happens over here. NP over NT was, I forgot what we said, 0.5. This becomes smaller, and S over NT becomes larger, and they partially compensate on theory. And D2 changes, and then you have to find out how much it changes. So we can reduce a little bit this voltage stress. But we decrease the duty cycle, and if we decrease the duty cycle, this stuff, this voltage increases. That is the first problem. Second problem, you have to be sure that even during transient situations, you never exceed too much this 0.33, this 1/3 of duty cycle. Because if you go to 1/2, if you be transient, go to 1/2, just for a few cycles, because you change the load or something like this, what happens? It happens that duty cycle goes to 0.5. Because you use an integrated circuit controller that has a maximum duty cycle of 0.5, so you play safe. Your transient duty cycle goes to 0.5. It means that the input voltage over here will be Vin times 0.5, as average, part of the average voltage, but the reflected voltage is less than V, it's 1/2 of V, because NP over NT is 0.5. So you have you are charging your primary winding with Vin for 50% of the time, and you are discharging it during D off by 50%, because D off in this case is just 50% of your time, with a voltage that is only 1/2 of what you charge it with. And so you don't discharge completely. This small climate must work in DCM. If your duty cycle becomes too long, you don't discharge, and the
magnetizing inductance. The first type one is okay, probably the second is okay, the third may be, the fourth it explodes, because you are unable to discharge it. If you want to go for this solution, you must be sure that your maximum capacitor does not exceed 0.3 or point something like this. Otherwise, you risk infringent conditions, not the steady state is worse, but infringent conditions, you risk to be unable to discharge the magnetization and magnetizing energy in your transformer, and it just needs 3-4 cycles to stabilize. Okay? That is one disadvantage. Second disadvantage, if you reduce the maximum duty cycle, it means that this switch works for a shorter time. This transformer works for a shorter time. And it turns out that the current, the input current, must be the same. So if the average input current is the same and you shorten the duty cycle, the peak value, the peak current goes up. Too bad. And this transformer, you pay for it, and you use it only 40% of its time. No, even less, 30% of its time. And it's not a good exploitation of this transformer. You are using this transformer only for a very short period of time. So you stress it, the wires must be larger gauge, and more expensive, etc. So going down with duty cycle is not a very great idea, because you risk, you have one advantage, less stress on the switch, but more disadvantage is higher currents, you risk the saturation, etc. I told you, I think, that in a buck converter, the best duty cycle you are hoping for is 100% or so, as large as possible. Another idea could be, oh, okay, let's set the max for my flow converter point, let's say 0.7. That's a larger value. I exploit my transformer, I use my transformer for 70% of its time. That's okay. My switch 70% of its time, that's okay. What happens? Well, it happens that if Dmax is 0.7, NP over NT must be, because I need to discharge the primary, the magnetizing inductance, must be 0.7 divided by 0.3. How much is 0.7 divided by
0.3?
2.3. Okay, I can wind it. NP with a smaller number of turns. But if NP over NT, NP over NT becomes 2.3, the input voltage stress becomes huge, because you have your input voltage plus the input voltage multiplied by 2.3. So your voltage stress on the switch is 3 times or more than the input voltage. It's really like walking on a rope. You have to balance very carefully stresses, etc. And the best solution most of the times is go for a point maximum, absolute maximum, transient maximum, 0.5 duty cycle, and use a steady duty cycle, a steady state duty cycle of 0.49, because it's just a little bit less than 0.5. Your maximum duty cycle should be around 0.4, not more than that. Even if your controller, even if your circuit can work with duty cycle of 0.5, don't go close to the 0.5 value. Stay quite low. Because this is a buck derived converter. And in a buck derived converter, you have these inductors in series with the output. Inductors are good guys. They are used for as a filter, to smooth down and the voltage to have a nice current ripple, etc. But those are inductances. And inductances have a differential equation which is di by dt equals V of L. Now, let's suppose that your load changes abruptly from minimum to the maximum. Your output current goes from a very low voltage, a very low value, sorry, to a very high value. Let's say from 10% to 90%. Where is this current coming from? Well, in friendship, this current comes from the capacitor. But steady state, this high current should come from the inductors. You have here, for example, 1 amp, you go from 10 amps, and this current change must eventually come from the inductors. Can an inductance change its current flowing fluid suddenly, like a step? No way. What do you need to change the current to an inductance?
High voltage.
Voltage and time. If the voltage across this inductance is not high, the voltage, the current will start to increase, but in long times. That means your inductance current will start to go up slowly. And this difference of current, where is it coming from? The load takes 10 amps. The inductance is giving 1 amp, and this current is increasing slowly. And what is the difference?
Capacitor.
And what does a capacitor deliver in current? What does a capacitor deliver in current?
It
charges. Your output voltage goes down. Oh, you say, but I am smart. I have a controller. I have a feedback. When the feedback senses that this current, this voltage goes down, it increases the cycle. It increases the voltage across the inductance. What if you are already at the stops? You are already at your maximum in cycle. You have not increased things. In a buck device converter, you need to work in steady state, somewhat smaller than the maximum duty cycle that the circuit can give you, because of transient. Because if you have a transient, if you have a sudden increase in the required current, you want to be able to increase this voltage a lot in order to pump up the current quick and fast. If your input voltage is at its maximum, so the duty cycle is at its minimum, you push on the accelerator and no problem. You get fast with no current. But if your input voltage is at its minimum, the duty cycle is already at its maximum. And you need some extra headroom for duty cycle to go up in order to make this transient faster. During this phase, when the inductor gives you less current than the load, probably your controller is slamming on the maximum duty cycle. It's giving 0.5 duty cycle. It would like to have more, but the maximum is 0.5 or whatever it is. If you go behind the 0.5, you saturate the transformer, so the maximum is 0.5, and it bends against the stops. Space there. And it works. And the controller, type 3 controller, type 2 controller, just saturates. The op-amp is saturating, the output goes to the maximum, trying to ask for a larger current that does not come, because the duty cycle in any case is limited to 50%. And what happens is that it takes time. Type 3 controller, type 2 controller saturates, and when the output voltage goes back to the inductor current reaches the output current, so you are, your type 3 controller is saturated. It takes some time to come out from saturation, so you risk to have an overshoot on the output voltage. And this is not linear. You cannot analyze it using linearity, phase margins, things like this. When the control the satellites, it's not linear anymore. You're just waiting, and when you reach, it takes time to come out from saturation, and at this point you can go above the wanted bodies and come down. The only practical way to see this effect is to simulate it. If you want to write down the differential equation, you can. They are not difficult, but it's just a long job. Do you remember, no, you are too young, the old style Fiat car, 9500, old 500, a small, yes, the small two cylinders, 500 cubic centimeters, maximum speed was
100 kilometers, 90
kilometers per hour if you are going downhill and you have tailwind. Okay, let's suppose that you are traveling with this car at 18 kilometers per hour. Going. You have a big truck in front of you traveling 75 kilometers per hour. So you are approaching this big truck. Can you pass it? Well, you move to the left, you slam on the pedal, the gas pedal, but basically nothing happens. The speed, your car speed, goes up slowly, slowly, slowly. Theoretically speaking, you could pass the truck, but with a speed differential that is very small. So it will take a long time and a long bunch of road. You need a long leg of road to pass the truck. And it's not a very nice situation, because if somebody comes in the opposite direction, well, not a nice situation in any case. Here's the same story. When you want to increase, to go with this increase, like passing, needing more speed of your car, you don't want to be very close to the maximum, because when you slam to the gas pedal, you don't get some extra speed quickly. This is the reason why in buck delight converters, where we have an inductor in series to the output, it also happens for a boost converter, but we don't deal with boost. In a buck converter, when you have this inductor in series to the output, you want to be able to increase, at least in transient, your duty cycle by a lot, not a lot, but somewhat, in order to increase the voltage at this point, the average voltage at this point, and be able to increase the current to the inductor fast. Don't say, but I design a better controller, I go for a current mode. No, the limitation is 50% of the cycle and the maximum voltage you can get here. It's not a control limitation, it's a basic physical limitation due to inductors.
Sorry, I remember that we used a comparator in the previous lectures, a comparator that when the output voltage comes down to a threshold, the comparator enables some wire directly linked to the input voltage. In this case, we need isolation, so it's not possible to do it. Or we can do it at secondary winding, for example.
I told you about a schematic to boost the transient of a buck converter using a switch that was connecting directly the input to the output. That was easy to do if you had enough energy on the input side, because the input side has a higher voltage than the output voltage, and you have no isolation. Here you have isolation, you need isolation, so you cannot just put a switch between here and here, and then the voltage difference would be going up. And so if you have here 50 volts and you have here 450 volts, no way to put a switch and hope for current in this direction. But even in the other direction, I'm designing right now a converter that is 400 volts at the input, 30 volts at the output, it must be isolated. But even if it is not to be isolated, if you close the switch between here and here, you make a mess. Because you have 370 watts across a switch, and then you close it, and you don't know what happens over here. Absolutely, unfortunately, no. Not a viable solution. You need to have some extra duty cycle increase possibility in order to increase the average voltage on the left-hand side of this inductor, and to have extra DIVT to the inductors. Okay? So far, so good. And don't say, I go to 70% and then do this cycle. Three cycles at 70% of the cycle and you transform the center. So far so good? Okay. Current stresses. Magnetizing current depends on the magnetizing inductance of the transformer, and until you don't, you design the transformer, you know how much is its magnetizing inductance. And I switch. Well, ID1 is it. I forgot which one. Oh, D1 is the freewheel inductance. ID1 is something like E. Is something like this. Did you already see this current waveform? It's exactly the same as in the block conductor. This base is 1 minus D. We are working in CCM, so it's exactly 1 minus D. And this left off value is equal to output. And what about this ripple? It's a standard ripple that we have in a buck converter. This ripple is equal to dI by dt is equal to the voltage across the inductance during T off divided by the inductance. So divided by L. How much is the voltage drop across the inductance during T off?
V off. V naught.
Output voltage. And if you want to be very precise, you don't need, but okay, now you start to be more closer and closer to real engineers, and you want to put here the voltage drop across the diode, you can. So that will be V naught and possibly plus Vg. If you want to include with the diode effect, it's not important, usually. Unless you are here at 5 volts and this is a Schottky diode, so you have at least half a volt of the voltage drop. You know how to find the average value up here? Say yes. How much is the average value of this?
I not times. 1 minus D.
1 minus D. Do you know how to find the RMS current of this waveform? It's not important, we don't need it, but just to see if you remember.
Flat-top approximation.
Flat-top approximation, sure. That is I naught times square root of 1 minus D. How much is the peak value of this current? I naught plus 1/2 of the ripple, peak to peak ripple. It's exactly as in the Bach curve. Same story. Let's go to ID2. Yes, ID2. ID2 is the diode we added over here in order to allow for voltage reversal on the secondary side. This is the same as a switch in our buck converter, our original buck converter. Actually, this is the switch of our original buck converter. And so, ID2 has a current that is something like this. How long is this?
Deep.
How much is the flat top approximation? This
card.
I know. average current over here?
I know.
Times V. How much is the RMS current over here?
I naught times square root of V.
Is it important, this RMS current? Not directly for the diode most of the times, but it's important because this RMS current is also the RMS current going to the secondary one. And so this RMS current determines how much is the wire gauge over here. You see that the average currents to these two diodes depend on D. If you use D 0.4 or so, you get some current. But if you decrease D for any reason, if D becomes smaller and smaller, the average over here decreases, and the average over here decreases. The RMS current over here decreases, the RMS current over here increases. If you want to change a D over an S for some reason, and you change also this width, you change also these colors, these stresses. I switch. What waveform do we have for I switch? Well, I switch is there only during T on for a fraction of time that is D.
Starts from zero.
We have CCN. Switch current, the primary current. Primary current is equal to the secondary current with a term ratio in between. And secondary current is this one. We move it to the primary side and we get something like this. What's the amplitude
I knock the times
Yes, the secondary current moved to the primary side. So it being a current, the two subscripts are reversed. So we go from secondary to primary, and we have secondary and top and primary of one. Can you find the RMS value, the peak value, the average value of this waveform? Say yes. Probably it's not even alive this time. What happens if we decrease the duty cycle? May I say that if I decrease the duty cycle, the average current goes down? No, unfortunately not. If I decrease the duty cycle, well, it's false, becomes narrower, but if I decrease the duty cycle, I have to change NS over P. Because remember, what is important, V out equals V in times NS over NP times D. Here I can put the losses in. So if I decrease the duty cycle, NS over P must be larger. Duty cycle maximum is not 0.5, it's 0.25. Well, NS over NP must be twice as much. So, NS over NP is twice as much, I know it's still the same, and so if I decrease by a factor of 2 the duty cycle, this peak, this amplitude, becomes twice as much. This area stays the same. Why this area stays the same? What's the area of current to the switch? What is that area? Area means current times duty cycle. Well, is the average current flowing to the switch? Is the average current flowing to this winding? is the average current coming out from this node, is the average current coming from here. What is the average current coming from here? Is the input current. Input current times input voltage gives you the input power. If you have to deliver 100 watts to the load, you need to absorb at least 100 watts. So this area must be still the same value, still the same current. Okay? Are we done with spread current stresses? Capacitors, sure. This is a bug derived converter. Output capacitor is stress or not stress?
Not stress.
Oh, remember that if you read stressed backwards, you get. Not on the bench. Deserves. So, if you want to counteract the stress, use a deserve. Input capacitance is under heavy stress because this is a buck converter denied at least.
Could you think why the area of under E is the same?
Yes, because this area is the, we are in D, is the average input current. This stuff is I in average. And the input current stays the same, no matter what I do with my converter, because the input current is related to the power that I carry out in the load. So, if I have to deliver 100 volts, and my input voltage is 100 volts, my average input current must be 1 amp. 1 amp times 100 volts is 100 watts, which is what I have to deliver at the output. Well, even if I change this value, my average current is still the same, because I still need 100 volts. And my input voltage is 100 volts. So this average must stay 1 amp. If I make it narrower, it goes up. But because the area is the input current is related to the output power. Did I answer? Capacitors. Output capacitor is in a very good situation, quite not stressed. Input capacitor is under heavy stress, as in any buckle. The calculations for these stresses are the same, exactly the same as for the buck converter. We did it. So, IC0 RMS equals, this is the RMS value of a triangular current, equals I add delta I add peak to peak. The ripple, peak to peak ripple, current ripple through the L, divided by square root of 12. Why the square root of 12? Because there is a square root of 3 due to the triangular waveform, and then there is a 2 because here is the peak to peak value. I say in RMS, and bad news over here. Bad news because it's a buck derived. We have to find the RMS of something like this. This is like a buck converter that has a flat top current, this is IC, and this is I switch. The slope should be the same. This flat top approximation is I naught times MS or MP and we derive how much is the capacitor stress in under these conditions. Do you remember how much is the input capacitor stress for a buck converter? Worst case is I naught divided by 2. If you want to be very precise, but you don't have to, is square root of d times 1 minus d. And here, in a buck converter, we have to put I naught. This is not a buck converter, this is a follow converter. In a follow converter, the primary current is equal to I naught transferred to the primary side. So this is just I naught times Ns over Np. Basically, this is the IP, the primary current, the flat top approximation of the primary current, multiplied by this factor gives you the RMS capacitor. And as usual, if you go for a duty cycle that is 0.4 or so, your ICA RMS is almost equal to I naught over 2 times Ns over N. It's just like in a buck converter. We move the stress of the output current to the primary with this stir ratio, and it's still the same. Are we done with the stresses? Wait, what did I forget? The RMS current through the switch, you know how to find it, is the same RMS current to the primary winding. If we have a current mode control and the follow converter can be controlled both in voltage mode or current mode, your choice, we put here RS, standard advantages of being low side, and an RS over here has an advantage, a very good advantage. It protects the switch as usual. But if the transformer, for any reason, saturates, this opens the switch immediately. So it protects us even against the errors during the design and if this transformer saturates. You guys? You are not talking about something else, you are talking about this. This one?
Yes.
Okay, this is the standard equation. I naught times Ns over Np is the current flat top approximation moved to the primary side, and the RMS current through the input capacitor is given by this factor, d times 1 minus d under square root. We derive it. But if the duty cycle is close to 0.5, 0.4 is close to 0.5 because we are on a square root and there is a parabola, etc. 0.5 times 0.5 under square root is 0.5. And so the RMS current stress to the input capacitor is just I naught over 2, like in a buck converter, multiplied by the ratio that means moved to the primary side. Did I answer? Ask me, they pay me for to explain that. So far so good. Are we done? No. We are done with stresses. We are not done with losses. How much is the loss to a diode? How much is the loss to this diode? This is D1, is it? And this is D2. PD1, this is a diode. Diode is basically constant voltage across it when it conducts, so it's VD times the average current. This is PD1 equals VD times average current, this. That is I naught times, oops, not square. 1 minus d. Do we take d max or d min?
Min.
The minimum. Because we want to maximize the dissipation. We want to find the maximum of the stress. We don't want to maximize the stress or the power dissipation. PD2 equals VD, voltage drop across the diode, 1 volt for normal diodes, you know, a little bit more, 0.5 volts for Schottky diodes, times I naught, times D, max. And so the two diodes together, because I say together because they are quite often in a single package, the two diodes together dissipate a power that is PD1 plus PD2, right? Wrong. Wrong, because